to it, but he doesn't just change it on his own. Because if he did, a whole bunch of us would be way different by now. Amen. But he changes our lives as we plug into him, as we listen to him, and when we're corrected by him, we do what he says. Amen. Don't y'all love correction? Liars. You don't like correction. We should, but we don't. Amen. Hallelujah. So we had water baptism last week. We really had a great service because we had, at least three ladies from the recovery center for alcohol and drugs and stuff, and they brought friends. And I mean, there was one of the young ladies. She's here, and she'd been free from, was it meth, for 110 days, and she was being water baptized. She came to church, and she's got delivered, and her dad was sitting back there in the aisle, and he's just crying because he's a Christian. He's been praying for her for years, and he's just crying. He's so happy she's going to get water baptized, and her life is changing, you know. But it didn't happen overnight, and it wasn't easy. She had to find out some truth from the Word of God and apply that truth to her life before her life began to change. She didn't just sit down and look at the Bible and Jesus changed her life. Hallelujah. No, it takes us getting a hunger for God, finding out, first of all, how much God loves us. And I don't know about you, but one of the things I like about God is every time I screw up, he doesn't quit loving me. And he doesn't slap me anymore. In the beginning, I needed some slapping, but you know what I'm saying? And I'm so grateful that God just, you know, he knows what we're trying to do, and he loves us in the process, and that love is what got me through. And that love is what got that young lady through. You know, 110 days doesn't sound like a lot to some of us, but 110 days free from some of those drugs is a big deal. And her dad just crying, and he almost wouldn't let me go. He was hugging and hugging. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And how cool is it to see lives that are really changed? Amen. But for us, the changing of a life, whoa, Miss Tanassi, what's the baby's name?
Seth.
Welcome, Seth, to church. This is his second day at church. Praise God. Amen. And so, praise God. But God is good. Amen. And so, what I want us to understand is that God loves us, but our relationship doesn't stop with, oh, I feel so loved. No, now we do something with that love. I'm going to tell you what, in these last days, God's plan for us is to pass the love on, to pass the message on that Jesus Christ died for people to save them from going to hell, and so that they can get their life straightened out. But then we're all supposed to become ministers of the gospel. Everybody say ministers.
Ministers.
Amen. I'm not the only minister here. Y'all,
amen.
If you're born again,
amen,
are called to be ministers. You may not ever have a pulpit or anything or a microphone, but you're still called to minister to people. Amen. And I believe in these last days, we're going to have revival, but revival doesn't come from dead people. Revival comes from live people who press in and get hungrier and hungrier and want more of God. Amen. And so we've been talking about the baptism with the Holy Spirit. We've been talking about the tongues part and everything. And we're going to continue doing that. If you would turn over to Acts chapter 1 with me, praise God. You bring your Bible. If you didn't bring your Bible, look on with somebody. Praise God. Like Pastor Brian said, the Word is above all. Amen. And so Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and this is something that Jesus told the boys was going to happen. He says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And what Jesus is saying is when you get baptized with the Holy Spirit, when you receive the power, the indwelling, the many terms that are used in it, when he falls or whatever the terminology is, when you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he says you receive power to be a witness to him in the world. So when we're born of the Holy Ghost, when we're full of the Holy Ghost, we don't get power to sit and watch TV. We don't get power to play more games. And a lot of Christians, you look at them and you can tell they're wondering, where's my power? Where's my power? Well, God doesn't empower you to wonder. He doesn't empower you to mess around with ungodly stuff. He empowers you to do one thing, his will. He empowers you to be a witness to him in the world. And God, in these last days, I'm telling you what, he's calling us to wake up to what we're called to do. We're not called to just come to church on Sunday morning and say, well, that's it, now back to my job. No, your job is witnessing for Jesus. Wherever you are, whoever you're with. Are you all out there? God's expecting a revival, but he's not going to go and witness to everybody. Jesus is the head of the church. We're the body. How many of you have a body? If you want to pick up a coffee cup, do you do it with your eyes? If you want to get a check, do you do it with your ear? No, you pick it up with your hand, which is a part of the body. Jesus says, I'm the head of the church, you're the body. In other words, what he was saying is, I'm the head, the director, and I direct the body in what to do. And you and I as a body, we're supposed to obey Christ and be where he wants us and doing what he wants us to do, reaching people. Can I tell you something? If you haven't reached anybody in the last couple of years, you may be dead. Because our job as Christians is to reach people with the Word of God, with the gospel. Amen. It's not to become so satisfied in our life that we just come to church now and think that's good enough. Being a Christian is being alive unto God. Being a Christian is doing the will of God. Being a Christian is not just a name, it's an action. Amen. But everything that God has called us to do, we cannot do it without the help of the Holy Spirit, without the empowerment of the Holy Ghost. Are you out there? Amen. And so he says, you shall receive power. Turn over to 2 Timothy chapter 1 with me. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. Y'all doing good?
Yes.
Just smile. Pretend you're happy. Hallelujah. I mean, Easter's next week, and then I think Christmas is 3 weeks after that. The way things are going, it'll be 2019. 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. Watch this. Says, for God did not give us a spirit of fear. So if you have a spirit of fear, God didn't give it to you. Y'all listening to me? If you got a spirit of fear about anything, it's not from God. Amen. He says, but of power and love and a sound mind or self-control. Amen. And so he says in Acts 1:8, he says, you shall receive power. In 2 Timothy 1, he says, I didn't give you a spirit of fear, but I gave you a spirit of power. Praise God. Power is the ability to get something done. Amen. If you're empowered for something, you're empowered to do a job. You're empowered to get something done. Amen. And just becoming like the world isn't the job we've been given to do. Just becoming more insensitive to God, that's not the job. Becoming more comfortable, you know, it's sad when you can't tell the Christians from the world because we are so comfortable in the world. We shouldn't be comfortable in the world. We're called to be apart from the world. But most of us, you can't tell a Christian from a sinner. Because we all just do the same junk, the same thing. We should stand out. Amen. People should think you're strange. How many of you know it's okay to be thought strange when you're strange for God? Amen. You know, you and I, when we look so much like the world, nobody can pick us out. That's scary for us because we're not doing the job that God called us to do. Well, I don't want to stand out. Yeah, you don't want to do anything for Jesus. And let me tell you something. The way we get that way is we cool off on the things of God. And it's easy for us to cool off. Man, I'll tell you what. The Bible says in Romans, stir up the gift that's on the inside of you. Why does he say stir up? Because you and I, we need to stir up all the time. Because our flesh, how many know when you got saved, your flesh didn't get saved? Y'all out there? I mean, if you were bald when you got saved, you're still bald. Just saying. If you couldn't cook when you got saved, you still can't cook. Amen. Saving was the saving of your spirit, the regeneration, the new creation on the inside of you. You still have a mind that's stupid and a flesh that wants to sin. Amen. And so what we have to do is strengthen our spirit so that our spirit controls our thinking and our flesh. Because if we don't feed our spirit daily on the Word, and we don't, you know, and for those of us that are filled with the Holy Ghost and the baptism and all that, you know, if we don't pray in tongues, we're not going to strengthen our spirit. And then our flesh is going to win. And the way we are is if we allow our flesh to win, we quit fighting. And we just go along with it. You know, I'm trying to lose my belly. Don't be laughing. I can find something of yours too. I'm trying to lose my belly. And so I've changed my eating. I'm doing really well. You may not notice it, but my wife, when your wife says, you look thinner now, you know you're making headway. I don't care if she lies. But listen to me. I like to go to the gym. But one thing I know about going to the gym is if I don't go to the gym, it gets easier not to go to the gym. I cannot tell you how many times I have made this determination. Okay, Monday morning, I'm going to the gym. And then Tuesday comes. And I ain't been to the gym. And pretty soon after that, then you quit saying you're even going. Because you don't want to be a liar. Well, it's the same way with the Word of God and praying in the Spirit and pressing into the things of God. It can be very easy for us to quit pressing in. It can be very easy because it takes time to pray in tongues. While I'm doing my watch in my belly, I have a 3-mile walk I take around my blocks. It takes me about an hour, and I walk. But I pray in tongues the whole time. And man, when I get about halfway through praying, I mean, every time I do it, I just get pumped up because the when you pray in the Spirit, one of the things that does for you is it edifies you. It builds you up in your spirit, man. And the more I pray, the more I want to pray. The less you pray, not you in particular, I won't point, but the less you pray, the less you want to pray. And it's not you're like, I hate praying. It's just it's so easy not to. And you and I need to stir up because what changes, you know, Jesus will change your life. He won't change it until you press in. He's not going to, I mean, there are a lot of people with problems waiting for Jesus to change their life, and he can't do anything because they're waiting on him, and he's waiting on them. And if he's the one doing the waiting, your waiting is useless. Amen. The Bible says, draw near unto me, and I will draw near to you. Now, I mean, you know, the impetus is always with us first. It's like with Pastor Brian and the tithing thing. I really appreciate how well he's doing, and he's studying. But the tithing thing, some people are like, why is God trying to make me poor and why does he want my money? Tithing opens the door. Amen. Am I right, Jackie? What'd you say it does? It opens the windows of heaven. She and I were talking just earlier before the service, and she's all excited because of how God's blessing them, because they tithe and they give, and they're like, and God's opening all kinds of doors for them, because you tithing just shows God you're interested in His plan. It's not Him. He's not saying, now you better tithe because I need your money. God don't need your money. Going to be like the guy that snuck in his gold into heaven. And he goes up there and he's got his big bag, and St. Peter looks at him and says, what you doing here? What's this? He says, oh, I just got some things of mine. And St. Peter opens a bag and the guy's like, and it's all gold. And St. Peter says, you brought street material to heaven? Because the streets of heaven are paved in gold. But sometimes the things we think are important aren't important at all to God. Amen. Listen, I want to tell you something. There's a lot of junk in our lives right now. Now, I'm going to step on people's toes, but it's okay. I like to do that. Don't think you're special because I'm stepping on your toes. But I mean, you know, like right now, the big thing is March Madness. It's madness, all right. Because I wonder how many Christians there are that know more about March Madness than they do about Jesus and the Holy Ghost. I'm just using that as an example. Because we all have things in our life that overwhelm us and take more of our time than God does. And I'm telling you, in these last days, you and I, God needs to become number one. And we need to be giving Him our heart and our time and our voice. Amen? Because the world is coming to an end, guys. And Jesus is going to show up. And you're His missionaries. You're His emissaries. You're His voice. Are you out there? You and I, it's great to talk, oh, we're going to have a revival in Hillsborough. Everybody's going to get saved. Well, who's going to tell them? Somebody will. God. No, you. Amen. But the point I want to make is the more we're caught up in the Spirit, the more we pay attention to God, the more we pray in tongues, the more we come in line with what He wants done, and get rid of the junk that's just junk. And that's what we want to do, right? John chapter 14. John chapter 14, verse 16. Y'all are doing good, kind of. Amen. John chapter 14, verse 16. Now watch this. Jesus has been walking with the disciples for three and a half years. I mean, they pretty much know Him. And He's been instructing them and helping them and talking to them. And verse 16, He says, He's giving them some news of something that's coming up. He says, I will pray the Father, and He will give you another helper. And when He says another helper, He's talking about, in the Greek, that means somebody else just like Me. So He's telling them, I'm going to give you somebody else just like Me, and that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. I mean, you know, unsaved people can't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They don't even see it. They have no idea what's going on. And a lot of Christians don't either, because they've been blind to those things. But you know Him, for He dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. So he's telling them, He says, I'm leaving you guys, but I'm going to send you somebody just like Me, but He's not just going to pal around with you. He's going to live on the inside of you. He's going to be in you. Let me ask, how many of you are born again? You actually know you're born again. You know Jesus is Lord. You know that when you die, you're going to heaven. If you don't know, don't raise your hand. Okay. So, if you're born again, you have the God of the universe, the creator of everything. Come on. Living on the inside of you, and you have problems? I don't mean to be ugly, but when you've got the God of everything living on the inside of you, how do you feel lonely? How do you feel unloved? How do you still have mental issues? How do you still have physical issues? I mean, I'm just asking, because I don't know how it's possible to have the God of everything living on the inside of you, but I just don't feel like anybody likes me. Are you kidding me? God himself came to live in you because he loved you so much, and you don't think anybody likes you? Well, I just can't do anything right. You have the God who created everything, and you can't do anything right? Maybe you should listen to him, because he can do everything right. And he would probably like to instruct you. Well, I don't like being told what to do. I can tell. It shows. I mean, think about that, though. Jesus says, I'm going to leave you, but I'm going to send you somebody just like me. And he's going to live on the inside of you forever. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. Well, I just don't feel like God loves me. I'm sorry. God is on the inside of you. He died on the cross, and you can't figure out if he likes you. You're believing lies from somewhere. Amen. So God is on the inside of us. Now, it's going to get ugly, so don't get mad. Lock the doors. Now, listen. It's going to get ugly. God lives on the inside of each and every one of us who raised our hands. Jesus said, you're going to receive power to be my witnesses. What he is saying is you're going to receive the power to do everything I've been doing while I was here. You need to understand something. Jesus did not come as Almighty God to the earth to show lowly man how good he was. He came as a man, spent the first 30 years of his life as a carpenter, and then he was baptized in the Jordan River, where I also was baptized, only he got there first. He was baptized in the Jordan River, and the Holy Spirit came upon him, and the Father said, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. And from the time he was baptized with the Holy Spirit, he began to do miracles and signs and wonders and preach. His number one goal was to do the will of the Father. I wonder how many of us have strayed from the number one goal of doing the will of the Father, and now we've gotten bogged down with life. I want to tell you the truth. Jesus expects every one of us to do what he did. What did he do while he was here? He taught with authority. He healed the sick. He fed the hungry. And on his last day here, he died on the cross for everyone, so that anyone who heard about what he had done could be reunited with the Father and go to heaven with him. Our job is to continue his ministry, doing what he did. Y'all out there? I mean, I don't understand how people think they're Christians and they spend their whole life struggling to get over being them. Can I tell you something? This may come as a surprise, because, you know, we see so many people living in their past. You cannot drive your car effectively looking in the rearview mirror. When you got born again, you became a new creation in Christ Jesus. Your past is gone. Would some of y'all please just give it up and move on? I'm serious. I talk to people who are Christians, and all they talk about is their past. It's like, for crying out loud, get over it. Amen. Let it go and move on. Amen. Yeah, but people say, who cares? They're just people. But I've always had this problem. Well, you don't now. Come on. You need to do what I did. When I found out about this, that I was a new creation in Christ Jesus, and I found out all that stupid heritage stuff that came through my family, dear Lord, you want to know some weirdos? My Godfrey's. Everybody in my family had been divorced and remarried at least once. And most of them, 90% of them, were alcoholics. I mean, my family was bonkers. When I found out that I had become a new creation in Christ Jesus after 5 years of being married to my wife and she's ready to leave me because I kept that heritage. When I found out I was a new creation in Christ Jesus, I literally went out in the woods where I was logging and I just went, I cut that heritage off in the name of Jesus. And now I'm walking in my new heritage. And we don't fight and I don't drink and we don't do all that junk. Because I gave my life to God and I cut off the heritage. Don't cuss, don't drink, smoke, none of that stupid stuff anymore. But you have to, some of y'all just need to do this right now. You just need to go, I cut that off in Jesus' name. Some of y'all got cancer in your heritage, I cut it off in Jesus' name. Doesn't affect my new life. Amen. But if you continue to live in it, the devil will help you live in it. And there's nothing God can do. Did you hear what I said? There's nothing God can do. If you allow it, he will allow it. Because he's not going to impose upon your rights. You have a free will. You can serve God or you can serve the devil. You can, you know, and the devil, can I just tell you something? The devil loves when people read their Bible. The devil loves it when people go to church. Oh, yeah. As long as they don't live any of it. As long as they keep quiet about it on the job. As long as they don't tell anybody. Read your Bible. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Go to church some more. Yay, that's good. Oh yeah, raise your hands in church. Oh, that's good. But once you leave that church, don't you tell anybody. Okay. Mercy. The devil's a liar. I said he's a liar. And so Jesus says, I'm going to send you another helper. And another word for that is comforter. Amen. Comforter. And how many, you know, our thinking about comforter is, I need some comfort. Oh, I got to feel better. But the real live comforter, he doesn't come to pat you on the back when you're crying. Because the word comforter means strengthener. And when he comes to comfort, he strengthens you in the situation so that you can go on and do what God's called you to do. Can I just tell you the truth? God isn't he doesn't want you to be comforted the rest of your life. I lost my kitty. Oh, for the next 50 years, you lost your kitty. I'm so sorry you lost your kitty. Your kitty will be in heaven. That's a lie, but it'll be in heaven. Just to make you feel comfortable. No. The comforter strengthens us to face bravely what's going on and keep on moving. God has never done anything to keep you in the weakness you're in. Y'all out there? Everything God does is to get you over the weaknesses in your flesh and your mind and get you to a place where you're not affected by any of those weaknesses. Well, I've just never been able to think right. Well, get with God. He'll give you his mind. Yeah. Amen. The first year I went to Rhema, the neighbor guy that went with me, he was dyslexic. He'd never been able to read in his whole life. God told him to go to Rhema Bible Training College. So we're there in the class the first week, and within the first month, God fixed it. And the only thing he could read was his Bible. Couldn't read a book, but he could read the Bible. God fixed his eyes so he could read the Bible. Well, why couldn't he read anything else? He don't need anything else. It's just junk to keep your mind confused. Well, yeah, but I mean, I was talking to one of the little kids. I don't know if they're here or not, but one of the little kids in the back, he's just a young kid, and he's bragging, "I have a cell phone." I like to want to smack him and steal it from him. It's like, dear Lord, kid, you don't need a cell phone. You need something else. Y'all out there? We just heard of a young man. Been a Christian his whole life. Married, kids. Just heard about a young man. $82,000 in debt gambling on his iPad. Christian. No. Poser. Can I just tell you something? The devil knows every one of your weaknesses. He knows everything about you that can distract you and lead you away from God. Jealousies, gossip, ego, whatever it is. And the tempter is ever ready to visit you with whatever he thinks can carry you away from serving Christ and being a witness. You and I need to pay attention. Turn over to Mark chapter 14. I want to do this for you. Mark chapter 14. God wants us to have a personal relationship with him. And he wants us to spend time with him, not because he needs the attention, but because you and I need the attention. And God wants us to live a life that honors him and actually brings help to you. I mean, the devil, that young lady I was talking about that's been free from meth for 110 days, the devil would like nothing better than for her to relapse and let all her friends know this don't work. But in the name of Jesus, she ain't relapsing. We're here to support her and keep her free. So the devil gets no glory out of this, and God gets all the glory. Watch this. This is Jesus, and he's up on the Mount of Olives, and he's praying before he's going to be crucified. He's actually not on the Mount of Olives, but he's in that area. And chapter 14, verse 35 says, and he brought the disciples up on the hill to pray. He says, he went a little farther and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. I mean, you know, Jesus is saying, and you need to say this at some point in your life. You need to say, Father, not my will, but your will be done. Sometimes we go through say the prayer. You know, saying the prayer is good, but there has to come a time in your life where you say, Father, not my will anymore, but your will be done in me. Lord, inspect my life. Inspect my heart. And if there's anything holding me back from you, show it to me. For me, sin is anything that cools my affection for God. Did you hear me? If I start getting too involved in something and it takes time for me, takes time away from my Bible reading or my praying time, it's sin. Because it's taken me away from God. If it takes me away from God for a little bit, it can take me forever if I allow it. Verse 37, it says, then he came and found them sleeping and said to Peter, Simon, are you sleeping? Watch this. Could you not watch 1 hour? I mean, look at Jesus. He's like, you couldn't pray 1 hour? You fell asleep? Here I'm going through all this, and I've asked you to pray, and you're sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray, watch this, lest you enter into temptation. Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. And I hear some people, they're like, oh God, help me not enter into temptation. Oh Lord, don't let me enter into temptation. Oh God, help me don't. That's not what he's saying. He's saying you need to build yourself up every day so you don't enter into the temptation. Do you catch that? He's not saying, oh God, help me. Oh, I pray, don't let me enter in. No, he's saying you get so strong that you resist the temptations in your own life to move away from God. You give your time. And Jesus starts it out with 1 hour. I'll tell you what, you need an hour a day of time with God to not give in to those things you used to give into that want to take you back. Apathy, laziness, those things. Well, it's not a sin to watch TV 17 hours a day. No, but it's sure stupid. And it sure is taking you back from where you need to be. What? And he's saying it to us. He says, you guys can't pray 1 hour? That you build yourself up in the Holy Ghost so you can resist temptation when it comes? You ever heard anybody do something bad and you say, I couldn't help myself? Yeah, when you're weak, you can't help yourself. When you're not prayed up, you can't help yourself. Y'all out there? When you're used to giving in, it's easy to give in. But man, you get on the side of God and you start praying in the Holy Ghost and you start getting edified on the inside. Your spirit starts getting built up and charged up. Man, sin comes along and you go, not today. Just keep on moving, devil. This is no longer your property. But when you get a temptation, you know, and I just bring this up because it's one of my favorite ones, because it's probably one of the major temptations for guys, is when I was driving a log truck and the Lord said, and I was looking at the girls, ogling the girls, girls. And I'm married with 3 kids. And the Lord says, when you see a girl you want to look at, look away. What's he doing? He's saying that temptation is going to take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. Well, I'm just looking. Yeah, but the devil knows it's an easy way to get you out of the Word, steal 50 minutes out of your 1 hour of prayer. Y'all out there? Women have their things, guys have their things, and the devil knows what each one of yours is. And you and I, we need to be prayed up so when that temptation comes, and he says, when you look the other way, take your mind with it. In other words, don't be thinking about them after you quit looking. What's the devil do with you? He brings up something, and you shove it off, but he keeps bringing thoughts. Keeps bringing thoughts. And if you're not smart, you just keep thinking those thoughts and thinking on them until you end up doing it. $82,000 in debt for gambling on an iPad. Christian. And you think you're invulnerable? And you think you got this under control? Not without your prayer time. Not without my hour walk, praying in tongues, getting built up. And what's fun for me is the more I pray in the Spirit, the more I want to pray in the Spirit. The more I do pray in the Spirit, and the more I pray in the Spirit, the more built up I get, and the more built up I get, then when something comes along, I immediately identify the source. And if it's not godly source, goodbye. Because anything that steals my time from God is sin. What's your rule? What's your standard? How do you walk? It's a personal thing. But as for me and my house, we're going to honor the Lord. And Jesus is Lord of my house, of my home, and my life. And I do mess up, but I don't like messing up. What's sad is if you don't even realize the presence of God has lifted from you. What's sad is if there's nothing really spiritual going on in your life, but you think you're okay. What's sad is if you haven't led anybody to Jesus in a long time, but you think you're all right. Jesus said, "You'll receive power to be my witnesses where you are and where you go." He didn't say, "You'll receive power to become more like the world and not care about people and not care about the lost." This morning, you're in the house and you don't even realize the power's gone. Your relationship with God has become so lax that you don't even realize how far you are away from Him. And I trust that the Holy Spirit right now is talking to a bunch of us. My desire is that if you're in this place and what I'm saying is penetrating what the Holy Spirit's trying to get across, that He's looking for a group of people who are hungry for Him and thirsting for Him. And you say this morning to yourself, "That's not me. I serve in church, but that's not me. I don't sin, but I'm not hungry." What I would love to see, if you're in that kind of situation, is for you to come down here this morning, just come to the altar. Bow down before God Almighty. Cry out to Him. Say, "Lord, forgive me. Father, help me stir up. Help me stir up the love of God in me. Help me stir up the power of God in me." Father, forgive me for not being about Your business. Forgive me about being about my business. Father's looking for a revival. Revival is when those of us who know Him get hungrier for Him, want more of Him, and will not be satisfied with anything less. When we make a determination, I'm going to pray. I don't care what I have to give away to do it or give up. I'm going to pray and build that relationship with my Lord, my Savior. So I invite you. Come on down. Just kneel down at the... This isn't me laying hands. This is you and God. Is there anybody in here who's never made Jesus Christ their personal Lord and Savior? Is anybody here that if you were to die, you don't know if you'd go to heaven or hell? Is there anybody in here that you have said the prayer at one time, but after today you realize that my life is not depicting the life of God? I've backslidden from the excitement and the joy that I had. Anybody in here, you say, that's me, Pastor. I need to get saved. I need to rededicate. Anybody? Well, let me tell you, there's never going to be a great revival until there's great repentance. There's never going to be a great revival until the people of God become very hungry. There's never going to be a great revival until the people of God give up their sin. And I'm telling you, there's going to be a great revival. But the Bible says so many times, those that endure to the end will be saved. Endure doesn't mean put up with it. But those that walk in victory in Christ and never give up. God's calling us to be His messengers with the truth that sets men free. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Father. Well, I'm going to continue praying. I'm going to pray for these people up here. Just lay hands on them and pray for them. You're free if you want to be gone, if you could do it quietly. If you want to stay and just pray where you are, seek the Lord, that'd be excellent. But if you want to go right now, you're dismissed. And we love you, appreciate you, and thank you. Praise God. But we're going to just continue praying just a little while. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord.
let the wind come have your way. So know that you are here now. Still my heart, let your voice be all I hear now.
I want to be the man that God can use. Do you hear me? I want to be the kind of man that my Father can use. Amen. By seeking Him, hungering for Him, and spending time with Him. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for staying. We're in for something good. God bless you.